This is Business Analytics Using Forecasting. I'm Galich Mueli. In this second part of two videos, we're going to continue talking about including external information into regression models. In the previous video, we looked at including special dates and historical outliers into a model. In this video, we're going to look at how to include external time series that are either causal or correlated into our series of interest. We're going to try and answer the question how to do it, and then whether it's worth it. External time series that can potentially improve our forecasts are those that are correlated with our series, either due to a causal relationship or due to simple correlation. We'll use the notation X to denote such an external series. Examples of a causal relationship include the effect of oil prices on airfare or the effect of advertising on sales. So for forecasting airfare, we might want to include oil price as an input. For sales forecasting, we might want to include advertising expenditure as an input. Examples of series that correlate with our series of interest include ratings of a TV show that correlated with the Twitter activity about it, or the so-called lipstick indicator, which says that lipstick sales go up just before economic crisis. In either case, we can integrate a causal or correlated series in the exact same fashion. Let's see how. A popular approach is to take a two-step approach to include either a causal or correlated series. In the first step, we take each of our series, both our series of interest and the external series, and remove all possible trends and seasonalities. They might have different trends and different seasonalities, so we make sure we remove all of those ahead of time. Only after we do that do we include lags of our series and/or possibly the external series as predictors in our regression model. Which lags of the external series to use is an important question to consider carefully. First of all, you can use your domain knowledge. For example, if you know that advertising should have a 1 month ahead effect, then maybe you should include a lag one of the advertising into your model of sales. Sometimes you'd simply use exploration. You try different correlations at different lags and then find the ones that you need to include. Make sure to do this only after you remove trend and seasonality from both the series. For example, if both series follow the same trend, you might find very high correlations that are simply due to the trend. And two issues that we need to think about very carefully are going to be related to data availability. Let's look at these two issues next. The first issue relates to the form of the predictors that we're going to put into our model. Suppose that we're trying to forecast airfare, and we want to use oil prices as an input. Ideally, we would have wanted to include oil price at the same time period that we're trying to forecast. For example, in this equation, we're trying to forecast airfare at time t plus 1, so we would have wanted to know oil prices at time t plus 1. Obviously, we don't have that information because oil prices are very hard to know in advance. So we're going to have to change the form of the predictor here. One option is to use a lagged version, where we take oil prices at the last time point that we actually have measured. If we're currently at time t and we're trying to forecast airfare at time t plus 1, we will include oil price at time t. This is called a lagged predictor. A different option is to actually include oil price at time t plus 1, but not to include the actual value, but rather its forecasted value. So we're going to have to forecast oil prices and then plug in that forecast into our airfare model. This is called a forecasted predictor. In this case, it's probably going to be very difficult to do this because if I can forecast oil prices, I'm probably no longer interested in airfare. The second issue is another aspect of data availability. Specifically, it relates to delays in obtaining the external series and the needed forecast horizon of the external series. For example, suppose we want to forecast daily ice cream sales and would like to include the daily maximum temperature as an external predictor. Ideally, for sales on day t plus 1, we would want to include the maximum temperature on day t plus 1. However, that information will not be available at time t. Therefore, we can use a lagged version of maximum temperature, as we mentioned in issue 1. However, another issue that arises is when exactly on day T are we generating the prediction? If it's in the morning, we still don't know the maximum temperature for day T. So we therefore have to wait until day T ends in order to use this model. Or if we're using a weather forecast, we must consider when this weather forecast is made available. For example, we have weather forecasts for tomorrow that were generated today, yesterday, and last week. Which one exactly will we be using in our model? That depends on availability of weather forecasts at the time of prediction. Different choices will typically lead to different performance, so make sure you know what data exactly you're going to be using. These two issues affect two choices. One is the form of the external series and the lags that we're going to use, and the other is the performance evaluation. In the performance evaluation, we'll have to think about what information is available in the training period and what is de facto the forecast horizon. This might remind you of the video from week 2 where we talked about forecasting the future or the past. We talked about the bottom line of pretending that you are at the exact time of deployment and checking what data is available at exactly that time. Here's an example from a study by researchers Assur and Huberman at HP Labs in California. They tried to see whether they can better predict box office revenues of a movie during the opening weekend by using the activity on Twitter about the movie in the most recent week. Here's the model that they created. To predict box office revenues at time T, they used the daily tweet rate in each of the 7 days preceding the movie's release. These predictors are lagged. Also, they included the number of theaters at time T. While this predictor is not lagged, information about the number of theaters a movie will show in is usually available in advance. Therefore, there's no need to use lagged or forecasted versions of this predictor. Here are the researchers' statements relating to the issues of data availability. They comment about our first issue. In all cases, we're using only data available prior to the release to predict box office for the opening weekend. They also talk about the timing of availability of the external series. They say, since historical information on tweets are not available retrospectively, we were able to use data on only the movies we have collected. So this is an example of statements by people who've conducted a study where they actually deployed the model and had to make sure that all the data that they used was available at the time of prediction. So to summarize, make sure your forecasting model uses external information in a valid fashion. Think carefully about the forecast horizon that's needed for the external series. Determine the availability and its exact timing of this external information. And finally, evaluate performance using the same approach that we discussed throughout this course, using a training and validation partitioning and examining predictive accuracy metrics and charts. The best advice to help you use external information in a proper way is to mimic the deployment scenario. Try to pretend that you're deploying the model. Think carefully what data you would have at that moment exactly. A note about integrating external series into an ARMA model, and this is a little bit of a technical note. There are two ways to add these external predictors, in both cases after removing trend and/or seasonality. One is by directly adding the external series as a predictor in an ARMA model. This is also called ARMAX. The second way is to include the predictor alone into a regression model where the errors are assumed to follow an ARMA model. The ARIMA and AutoARIMA functions in the forecast package in R apply the second option. Specify the external series in the argument xreg. For example, this ARIMA command will fit a regression with AR1 errors. These two approaches are based on mathematical derivations and both yield similar results in terms of forecasting, so you can choose either. The advantage of the second approach is that the beta1 coefficient is actually interpretable. You can read more about this in the blog post by Professor Rob Heinemann at the URL below. Some software, such as Excel Miner, do not have these options. If you find yourself in such a situation, you can use as an approximation just a linear regression with all the predictors of interest. You can then examine the residual series and, if needed, capture the remaining autocorrelation with an AR model. A major question that you want to ask yourself when you're going to include external information is whether all this complexity is worth the effort. There are a few things to consider. First of all, there's an effort of collecting and managing more data. It might seem easy when it's all inside your file, but going and collecting it and maintaining it and avoiding delays and coordinating it can be a real challenge. The second effort is that you're building more complex models. We saw now the types of regressions that we're using. These are definitely more complicated than the extrapolation models that we saw earlier. So those are the major two efforts that we're talking about. There are also risks when you're using external information. One is that maybe the external series that you've built into your model will all of a sudden not be available in the future. Now, that's always a risk with the series that you're using anyway, but if you're adding external information, then the risk becomes bigger. Another risk is that this relationship that you discovered between your series and the external series, maybe it changes over time. Maybe things are measured in different ways, or maybe the whole environment changed. So in that case, you'll have to remodel or refresh your model every once in a while to check that the relationship still exists. Of course, if these two are worth it, then you'll find out when you check their benefit. How do we check the benefit? We use the same methods that we discussed earlier. We ask ourselves, is the predictive performance substantially improved? We look at charts, and we look at metrics, and we evaluate the practical usefulness. So what's the bottom line about external information? Potentially, external information can help us improve our forecasts. There are different types of external information. There are special dates, there are historical outliers, there are interventions, and then we also have time series that are either causally or correlated with our own series. We can include all of these different types of external information using regression models. And the two-step approach says first, detrend and deseasonalize each of your series, and then use lags of the external series, maybe also of your own series, as predictors into the model. Importantly, consider the issues of data availability that we discussed. Specifically, at the time of deployment, what data are available exactly? This will impact the way and the form that you include your predictors, whether they're in lagged form, whether they're in forecasted form, or maybe they're known in advance. And carefully consider delays in getting and putting in those external series into your model. Most importantly, ask yourself whether this extra complexity, which is costly, is actually worth the effort. Sometimes it is, but sometimes it is not. With this video, we conclude talking about integrating external information, and we conclude talking about regression models for forecasting.